Good afternoon and welcome everyone, and a warm welcome to for those who are joining us via our live streaming, more of Kenny's family and friends from around the UK, and of course Sammy and her family in Australia. My name is Susan Clinch, and it's my great privilege to support you as you come together today to say your final farewells to the physical presence of Kenny in your lives. Kenny came into chapel to that beautiful music, only timed by Enya. Kenny wanted Enya, and Pax chose only time for him. And this is just so indicative of how Kenny and Pax were over their 54-year marriage. They didn't marry just to be married, they married so they could be together. And together they truly were. They were always by each other's sides, doing everything together. They were soulmates, a gorgeous couple, both inside and out, and an absolute match made in heaven. Although Kenny really did live a full and fulfilled life for his 79 years on this earth, his life was becoming more difficult over the past year, as pancreatic cancer really took a hold on him. And the last weeks in particular were so hard for both Kenny as they prepared to set the bar. But these difficult times should not be allowed to define who Penny was. And so today, we will remember the real Penny, your very likeable and cheeky chappy Kenny. Kenny didn't just live life, he blooming well loved life. And when he knew that his time on Earth was drawing to a close, he discussed his service with Pat. Kenny chose the music we will be listening to, and he made some quite specific requests. And so we'd better do as we're told, haven't we? And so to start our service of celebration for Kenny's life, Pat has chosen to listen to the most beautiful hymn, Morning Has Broken. Now sadly, COVID-19 has stopped us singing this hymn, but it can't stop us enjoying this hymn together for Kenny. So stay sitting and sing along to yourselves. The words are on your service sheets. And let's really imagine ourselves singing at the tops of our voices as we play this lovely hymn just for Kenny. It is now my privilege to share with you all just some of Pat's memories of the more poignant moments in Kenny's life. Kenneth George Pike was born on the 12th of March 1941 in the Mother's Home Hospital in Hackney, London. Kenny was the second born child of Rachel and George Edward Pike, and he had an older sister, Junie. The Pike family home was in Leighton, East London, and although Kenny didn't talk much about his younger years, we know he had a good childhood and was lucky to be born into a close and happy family. However, Kenny was born 2 years after World War II broke out, and these were scary times for everyone living in London at that time. Junie, she remembers the air raid siren going off once, and her mum shouting at her to get Kenny out of bed and into his duffel coat, which she duly did. Kenny was so tired that he just stood there with his duffel coat on, still asleep. He went to his local Farmer Road school in Leighton, and he met his lifelong friend Dave there. They actually celebrated their 60th birthdays together. That would have been around 19 years ago, of course. Now going back to the 12th of March 1962, it was Kenny's 21st birthday, and he went to a dance with a friend to celebrate. And this is where and when he met the love of his life, Pat. Pat was also at the dance with a friend. It was not too long after that dance that Pat, during her work lunch break, was walking down the street and passed Kenny, who was sitting in the gutter waiting for his friend. And as she passed, Kenny said, "I'm going to take you out." And Pat answered, "Are you?" "Give us your address," said Kenny. And he cycled out to Pat's home address in Walthamstow, near Epping Forest. And getting there, Kenny exclaimed, "I didn't know you lived in the country." He'd come round that very night to take her to the pictures. He was keen. And it was while they were running for a bus that evening that Kenny declared, "You know I'm going to marry you." And marry they did. On the 26th of March, 1966, at St John's Church in Walthamstow. And as we've already said, this was the start of a long and very happy 54 years of married life together. They had each found their true love and soulmate. Although Kenny was keen to marry the love of his life, he was also a very responsible person, and he determined that they would not get married until they had their own home. And having saved and saved, they bought their first home in Leighton, all ready for the young married couple to move into. Kenny was a hard worker for all of his working life. When he left school, he took on various jobs, eventually working as a postie in the International Law Company where Pat worked. And he took on this job because it allowed him more time for the grueling process of studying the knowledge needed to be a London taxi driver. He had to memorise hundreds of street names and the quickest journey routes between them. Kenny was quick to learn and soon loved driving his taxi around London. And it's a testament to how popular he was with his customers that he used to receive Christmas cards from a lot of them. And Pat remembers that once he was taking a film director to wine and dine a potential actress. However, after dropping them off at the restaurant, Kenny later found the director's wallet in his cab. And Kenny, being so honest and kind, drove back to the restaurant to find a slightly panicked director who had just realised his lack of ability to pay for the meal. And Kenny, with his lovely manner and cheeky grin, simply said, "You owe me 10 bob." The film director later showed his appreciation to Kenny by giving him tickets for the film review. When Pat was 58 years old, she was able to retire from work. And Kenny said, "Well, if you're going to retire, then so am I." And so they retired. And both being sun worshippers, they decided to buy a villa and move to Javier on the east coast of Spain. And while there, they were even extras in the TV programme Benidorm twice. And Kenny loved it. When the director asked him to just simply stand and look across the swimming pool, Kenny, being Kenny, had to make a dramatic hand gesture as if he were looking out to sea. Pat could see the director was less than impressed with this extra who had added such panache to his acting. Now, after spending 15 wonderfully happy and sociable years in Javier, where they made so many more friends, and despite a diagnosis of skin cancer, which Kenny overcame, they were relaxing and sitting around their pool one day when Kenny simply said to Pat, "Shall we go home?" And as we know, they were always a close, tight-knit team. And so the decision was made to sell the villa and come back home to England. They first lived in Billingford in Norfolk, and then 4 years ago moved to their lovely bungalow in Dereham. Kenny had lots of interests over the years. He really enjoyed watching football, cricket and snooker, well, any sport really. In his lifetime, he was once a referee for local football clubs. And when young, he followed Leighton Orient, of course. In later years, he also enjoyed following Liverpool. But if you asked Kenny which team he supported, he would simply say he just supported football, full stop. Kenny had done up and owned a few camper vans over the years. And Pat has lovely memories of when they would go out with their friends and their children for the day once to Camber Sands, where so much fun was had. Lenny recently took fancy to a camper van that his friend was selling. And so Pat secretly bought it for Kenny as a surprise for his birthday. Kenny exclaimed, "Blimey, I normally just get socks and pants." Kenny and Pat also enjoyed some lovely holidays and cruises too. They sailed around the Mediterranean and the Caribbean. They also visited their friends in Australia several times. And Pat said to me, "We really did have a lovely life, and we enjoyed it together so much." Kenny made so many friends throughout his lifetime, too many to mention you all individually. But you all know who you are, and you should all know how much your friendships meant to him. Kenny had a huge character and a big personality. He brought so much joy and fun into the lives of those around him. He truly was a one in a million person. He was godfather to four children, Stephen, Daniel, Jane, and of course Sammy, who he really did love so much. He took an interest in all of his godchildren's lives, but without question, he and Sammy had a special relationship. The teddy that you see with Kenny today sat on his pillow, bringing him comfort over his last few weeks, and it was sent to him from Australia by Sammy. He enjoyed the good old TV shows, Two Ronnies, Open All Hours, Morecambe and Wise, and his favourite, of course, was Only Fools and Horses. He would be in charge of the TV controls at all times and was most miffed that their Alexa wouldn't accept his voice. Pat had control over that at least. His wonderful sense of humour, the way he could kid people, and simply by saying silly things, make people really laugh. He was such a kind man and a good friend to everyone he met. And of course you all know with his handsome looks how he could really charm the ladies. Kenny really loved and cared for and looked after Pat. And even as he knew his time on this earth was short, he was still pestering their doctor, firstly for a blue badge for her car to help her get around easier. And then he asked the doctor for another favour, which resulted in Pat having her kidney operation in July, because Kenny wanted to still be around to look after her. When I asked Pat what she was most proud of Kenny for, she answered without hesitation, "For just being him." With his kidding and his messing about and his silly humour, he could be a bit of a sod at times, but Kenny was Pat's bit of sod. He was handsome and funny and kind and loving, and this world is going to be a much sadder place without him in it. I'm now going to hand the lectern over to Tracy, who is Pat and Kenny's neighbour, and she's going to pay her a tribute. Thank you. He is gone. You can shed tears that he's gone, or you can smile because he has lived. You can close your eyes and pray that he will come back, or you can open your eyes and see all that he has left. Your heart can be empty because you can't see him, or you can be full of the love that you shared. You can turn your back on tomorrow and live yesterday, or you can be happy for tomorrow because of yesterday. You can remember him and only that he is gone, or you can cherish his memory and let it live on. You can cry and close your mind, be empty and turn your back. Or you can do what he would want. Smile, open your eyes, love and go on. And I think Kenny had a very positive part to play in all of our lives. And I know he would want us all to keep smiling, even today. And as in the words of his chosen song, which you'll hear shortly. And now Mike is going to read us his tribute to Kenny.
We've all come here this afternoon to celebrate and pay our respects to the life of Kenneth George Pike, a very dear friend and compatriot to us all. We have heard how he and Pat met, how long they've been married, how much of a loving couple they are, and how they influenced the people that came into their lives. I'm here now to put a little meat to the bones from the family point of view. Most of you will not know who I am. My name is Mike and I am Pat's cousin. I first met Ken, and to me he will always be Ken, when I was but a lad of 13. I'm now 72, so it's been a long time. He was introduced to the Sayer family over the Christmas celebrations in 1962. It must have been quite a daunting prospect for him, as the family were not known for keeping their opinions to themselves. From memory, he coped very well, and to me especially, he made a big impression. Compared to the previous incumbent, he was a great improvement. To him, I would probably seem like the nerdy cousin who wasn't particularly interesting. I wasn't interested in football or sport in general, and wasn't old enough to be concerned with girls, so the conversation could be a little limited. That did change though when everybody else had gone to bed and left the pair of us to sleep on the floor in the front room. He discovered that I did have some advantages. I knew how to tune into the police frequencies on the radiogram and was quite happy to raid the fridge for a midnight feast as the need arose. He also came with some advantage. He had a car, a common cob, I seem to remember. None of the family at that point had taken the plunge and learned to drive, so a current boyfriend with his own transport was a bonus. Before long, he had been convinced of the necessity to celebrate Christmas in the Sayer tradition. This amounted to carting the relative dads and me to the Jewish bakers in Stamford Hill in order to pick up the bread, drop into the local cemeteries for the annual wreath placing, and finally onto the Swan Public House for the Christmas drink with the extended family. His face did drop somewhat when arriving back home and being presented with the Christmas dinner. We were a family of butchers, and as can be imagined, the portions were not exactly nouveau cuisine. To give him his due though, he handled it all very well, and in his customary good humour, warmed him to the family. All the male members of the family belonged to the Jubilee Angling Society, a fishing club steeped in tradition, and to a man were enthusiastic partakers of the sport. In the fullness of time, Ken was encouraged to accompany Pat on the odd social outing that they ran, just to gently introduce him to the sport and hopefully encourage him to take it up. A favourite venue for the events was along the River Thames at Staines. Ken had many a happy hour sitting on a little wooden stool, clutching an umbrella over Pat and himself as the rain poured down. It always rained when we visit Staines, and I had the photos to prove it. Understandably, I suppose, he never quite got the urge to take up fishing. As time rolled on, as it does, it came to pass that he and Pat became engaged to be married. As you have already heard, they got married in 1966. I remember it well, sitting in St John's Church, Walthamstow, the rain pouring down outside, and the bride, as is customary, was late. I could still see Ken anxiously turning round waiting for something to happen, only to be greeted by one of the guests who had a particularly loud, booming voice, informing the congregation of the state of the weather with some well-chosen expletives. Even the organist paused at that point. Before long, though, the arrival of the bride was announced with the customary wedding march, and their wedding proceeded to the congratulations of all. It was from that point on a fully paid-up member of the family, respected, admired, and loved by all. Little did I realise that only 4 years later, Ken was to become my best man at my own wedding. That in itself nearly didn't happen. I was taken on a particularly liquid stag night and vaguely remember Ken and Pat steering me round Wanstead in the early hours of the morning, each one supporting me with their arms, with my arms over their shoulders. I was due to get married a few hours later, and this stroll was accompanied by the rather pointed dialogue that went along the lines of, "How the hell did you get him into this state?" from Pat, or words to that effect. As we all know, Ken was always ready with a story or a wind-up, or both. Much like the time when Pat and he were living in their old timber cottage just outside Bishop Stortford. On one of the visits where I took my two sons along, he readily convinced them that there was a ghost of a lady in grey living behind the fireplace. Their faces were a picture, and neither of them would dare to go out of the room on their own. And I'm not wholly convinced that even now, being in their 40s, they are still not certain it was a wind-up. But this could be said of Ken all through his life. Even through the recent months when his illness started to take hold, he never lost his sense of humour. His ability to relate a story and to make his visitors feel at home. He bore the final weeks with a stoic fortitude and a bravery, never complaining or regretting. Ken touched all our lives in many ways. He was always there with a ready smile, a raucous laugh, or a kind gesture of sympathy. During my own life, he has always been supportive, and along with Pat, are considered as my true friends. In this world, that can be something of a rarity. He passes from our physical world now, but spiritually, he will never leave us. There will always be a part of our memories where he will hold a prominent place. We say goodbye, Ken. May God speed you on your journey. May he keep you safe and secure in the knowledge that in this life you are a much loved man, a gentleman.
Thank you, Mike. Lovely memories, very insightful into Kenny's life. We're now going to have a moment of reflection for Kenny's life, and for this time, Kenny chose A Smile by Michael Jackson for us to listen to. Now, during this poignant song, Pat has placed these beautiful roses, and she invites you all to approach Kenny and leave a rose with him in memory of your own special and precious times with him. So as I invite each row to come up, I'll work from the front to the back, but because of strict COVID regulations, I must ask that you do not touch Kenny's coffin at all. I thank you for your understanding. When you're sitting back down, try to smile at your memories so that all of your love and thoughts go to him as we approach our final farewell.
When there are clouds
So let us now try to find some peace, some comfort and acceptance. Let us pray together. Blessed be God and our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us all with the gift of this earthly life and gave to us our brother Kenny. We thank you now for all of his life, for every memory of love and joy, for every good deed done by him and every sorrow shared with us. We thank you for his life and for his character. We thank you for the rest he now enjoys. We thank you for giving him to us. Hear our prayers through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's now join together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Now, as a show of love and respect for your dear Kenny, if you are able, would you now please stand for our final farewell? Kenny, we have been remembering with affection and gratitude your life on this earth. So it is in sorrow, but with deep love and warmth, we now commit your memory to our hearts. We thank you for everything that you did for us and all that you were to us. Pat misses you and loves you with all her heart, and she always will. We will all miss your presence, but we have learned so much from your character and from the way in which you lived your life on this earth. We are so thankful for your life, and we will remember all your cheekiness, the joy, the laughs, and the kindness you brought to us. And we will never forget how happy you could make us feel. You are loved, and you will be missed, Kenny, but you will always be remembered with a smile. Here in this last act, we commit your earthly body to its end and commend your soul to eternal rest. And in doing so, we move together into a new relationship with you, in spirit, in our hearts, and our memories. As the curtains now close on the physical presence of Kenny in your lives, let's listen to these words, which we feel Kenny would like to leave you with. My friends and loved ones, I am about to leave. My parting does not say goodbye, for my love for you is timeless and beyond the touch of death. I leave myself to your memory with love. I leave my thoughts, my laughter, my dreams to you. I give you what no thief could ever steal, the precious memories of our times together, the tender love-filled moments, successes we have shared, and hard times that have brought us closer together. I leave you also a solemn promise that I will still be present whenever and wherever you call on me. My energy will be drawn to you by the magnet of our friendship and our love. All I take with me as I leave is your love and your friendship and the millions of memories of all that we have shared. And so fear not, nor grieve at my departure, you whom I have loved so much, for my roots and yours are forever entwined. With our love and respect, Kenny, we now leave you in peace and say our final farewell. Please take a seat. Kenny was and remains a part of you. Treasure his memory and hold him close to you. You will carry him always in your minds and in your hearts. So let him continue to make you smile, and let him continue to make you laugh. We all know that is how he would want to be remembered. Pat would like to acknowledge and thank everyone for their kind support at this difficult time. And in particular, Pat has asked me to thank you, Mike, for everything that you've done to help her. and she sends a big thank you to you for being her absolute rock. Pat would also like to thank neighbour Tracy for always being there for her and helping her with all the 999 calls. Tracy's been such a huge support to Pat. And finally, Pat would like to send her special thanks to her neighbour Simon. Since the beginning of lockdown earlier this year, Simon has cut the lawns and done all of Kenny and Pat's shopping, and nothing has been too much trouble for him. So thank you, Simon. Donations in memory of Kenny may be given to Little Proud and Sons Funeral Directors in support of Kenny's chosen charities, Cancer Research UK and Guide Dogs for the Blind. Now, just before we leave chapel, we're going to listen to Kenny's last choice of song for us. It's Andy Williams singing Danny Boy. So let's listen for a moment and try to smile for Kenny so we can leave chapel remembering not just that Kenny has died, but that he lived. His full and fulfilled 79 years on this earth have left you with so many wonderful memories of the handsome and the loving, cheeky, likeable and fun man that Kenny was. And so as we come to the end of our time here together, I wish you all peace and happiness as you now move forward with Kenny tucked safely in your hearts.
Danny boy, the pipes are calling from glen to glen and down the mountainside. The summer's gone and all the roses falling. It's you must go, and I must bide. But come ye back when summer. I